Random House Audio presents Out of Order, Stories from the History of the Supreme Court, written and read by Sandra Day O'Connor. Here is Sandra Day O'Connor.
This book is dedicated to my law clerks who helped me learn, research, and appreciate the court's history, and to Craig Joyce, who encouraged me to write this book called Out of Order. It's written after my retirement as a Supreme Court Justice and with the benefit of 25 years of service on the court. I began my service there with admiration for the court, but trepidation about my role as a justice. I look back on it with continued admiration for the court and for my colleagues there. The court is as much needed today as it was when it began. Long may it survive. Introduction. On September 25, 1981, my first day as a United States Supreme Court Justice, I walked up the steps to the Supreme Court for only the second time. Decades before, I had visited the court with my husband John as a simple tourist while John was attending Army training in neighboring Virginia. It was a Saturday and the court was closed. I snapped a picture of John as he stood on the marble steps. I remember thinking that was the closest I would ever get to the Supreme Court. I could not have fathomed that years later I would walk down those marble steps as a member of the Supreme Court and serve for nearly 25 years. The Supreme Court building is an awe-inspiring sight. Many a visitor each year is stopped in his or her tracks by the grandeur and solemnity of the white marble staircase and the soaring inscription on the court's facade, "Equal Justice Under Law." An inspiring and profound image of permanence and continuity, the court stands as a symbol of our commitment as a society to the rule of law. It stands for our founding fathers' uniquely American vision of an independent judiciary, in which judges and the court would stand alone, independent, and not beholden to the will of political majorities in their interpretation of the laws and the Constitution. Most people would say that the reasons for having the legislative and executive branches of government are obvious. After all, we need legislators to make the laws. We need an executive to enforce them. The framers of the Constitution created a powerful national government to reflect and implement popular will. With the revolution against monarchical rule fresh in mind, the framers saw legislatures of elected representatives answerable to the people as the heart and soul of any system of truly republican government. And while memories of King George III's tyrannical reign fostered distrust of executive power, the framers also recognized the need for a vigorous presidency rooted in the will of the people. Under the Articles of Confederation, a weak national government had struggled to provide for the country's needs and speak for the people with a single voice. But why did the framers envision for the new government a judicial branch whose members, unlike those of the legislative and executive branches, would be unelected? And why was a federal judiciary necessary, given the extensive system of state courts in existence at the time of the founding? Today, state courts can still decide nearly any issue of law, and they still handle the bulk of our nation's cases. The framers wished to create an independent federal judiciary because they knew that the new national political branches could not be left unchecked. Our congressmen and president serve as elected representatives. In that role, they're supposed to speak for and answer to the people. For that reason, the framers did not rely on the political branches to protect minority groups with less popular, more marginal interests. And so they assigned federal courts primary responsibility in guarding against the overreaching and excesses of the political branches, recognizing the benefits of a judiciary that functions as an outsider to the system of majority will. The majestic building on 1 First Street in our nation's capital stands as a monument to our founding fathers' vision, erected across the street from the Capitol and across town from the White House. The building stands as a physical testament to the court's status as an independent, co-equal branch of government. The Supreme Court today regularly reviews the legality of laws passed by Congress and enforced by the executive branch. And from time to time, the justices find themselves compelled by the law to strike down invalid government action by the political branches. The court's decisions today, although often the subject of public criticism, are followed and adhered to even by those who disagree. Indeed, the court has withstood tests of its authority on matters as controversial as school desegregation in the 1950s and the conduct of the war on terror in the first decade of this century. I had the privilege of serving on the Supreme Court from 1981 until 2006 as it confronted issues running the gamut from states' rights and race-related affirmative action to a defendant's right to effective assistance of counsel. My colleagues and I always strove to reach the right answers, and I hope that we did. We were able to resolve tough questions in an atmosphere insulated as far as possible from political pressures. In those years, I also grew accustomed to many things that facilitate the important role that the Supreme Court plays in our system of government. For instance, it went without saying that at any given time, I had 8 colleagues who were well-trained in the law, committed to their jobs, and willing to spend years, even decades, as officers of the court. It also went without saying that the term followed a regular schedule, that we had personal chambers in which we could work, that we had available clerks and reporters' offices that ran like well-oiled machines. The staff at the court are first-rate professionals, and I had my pick of wonderful, talented law clerks to assist in my chambers each year. This was not always the case. Far from it. So many aspects of the court were shaped and developed little by little, year by year, person by person. The court was a daring, bold, but risky political experiment, and its beginnings were modest and uncertain. In reflecting on the court's humble early days, it is striking to note how dramatically the court and its practices have evolved, and how so much of that evolution was born of struggle and serendipity. I find it remarkable to reflect on how, for many decades of the court's early existence, so much of what we take for granted was steeped in uncertainty. The many justices who've come and gone have made contributions, dramatic and subtle, renowned and lesser known, to not only the law but the institution and its internal operations. In this book, I hope to shed light on some of those transformations. This book offers snapshots of the people and events that reflect the court's evolution and journey. From the array of characters who've served as justices, to the law clerks who've aided them, the advocates who've argued before them, and the staff who've worked behind the scenes, the makeup of the community of the court has changed dramatically. Just consider the criteria that presidents have laid out for Supreme Court nominees. President George Washington was looking for men who were strong supporters of the Federalist cause and the Constitution, men who had served in the Revolution, who were active in the political life of their states and who had the blessing of well-known Federalists, the party that favored a strong national government. President Obama has stated that he looks for men and women with a sharp and independent mind who understand that justice isn't about some abstract legal theory and who identify with people's hopes and struggles as an essential ingredient for arriving at just decisions and outcomes. The life of a justice is very different, too. In 1791, Justice John Rutledge left the job less than 2 years into it because, frustrated by the court's lack of activity, he preferred to serve on a lower court, the South Carolina Court of Common Pleas. In the early days, it was also not unusual for justices to leave the court to assume or run for political office. Justice David Davis resigned in 18...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.